Beautiful. Thank you, Dan. Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this morning. It's good that you are here. Warm welcome to guests and friends with us. We hope you find this time of worship meaningful. A few announcements before we continue with worship. We have 3 cards of the week this week on the back table. We haven't had any for a while, and now we have 3. So there's 3 cards back there. One will go to Kathy Peterson on the death of her sister, Vi. And then one to John, Mackie, and Mary Stone. They're both at Aspires Hospital. So please sign those cards and send your prayers. The prayer vigil service for Ukraine will be at Grace UCC this Wednesday at noon. Grace is right down here on South 3rd. So it starts at noon, goes till 1, serves itself in about 20 minutes, and then there's time after for silent prayer. Our last Wednesday midweek worship is this Wednesday at 6 o'clock. We continue our deep dive, and we finish our deep dive into Psalm 23. Soup supper starts at 4:45, and there are soup supper ingredients that are needed. There's a sign-up sheet out in that table right next to the card of the week. So check out that sign-up sheet and sign to bring some ingredients for those soup suppers. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday and the start of Holy Week. On page 10 in the bulletin, you'll see the schedule for Holy Week worship services, so please plan on attending those. There are lots more announcements in your bulletin, but please read those through at your leisure. Let us take a moment now to prepare our hearts and minds for worship. We say we love one another, but ignore the calls for justice and focus on our own lives. Forgive us. Call us into a consistent life where our values of love, mercy, and peace align with both our words and our actions. Call us back into your way of life in which we truly love one another, meet the needs of others, and welcome the stranger among us. Help us to follow you in all we say and do. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Over and over the Psalms sing to us that God's steadfast love endures forever. There is no time when God will stop loving you. There is nothing you can do that will remove God's love from you. God's steadfast love is with you now and always. Know that you are loved. Live into the ways of repentance, forgiveness, and restoration, and share the love of God in your words and deeds. Amen. Amen. We sing our gathering hymn in 339.
Thank you.
reading and call to worship, as printed in your bulletin. Our call to worship this morning is our psalm for today, Psalm 126. From our God, who loves us with an everlasting love, who brings forth a new creation in Christ, who leads us by the Spirit in the wilderness, grace and abundant mercy be with you all.
And also with you.
The Lord brings us back to Zion. We are like dreamers, laughing, dancing with songs on our lips.
A nation safe, a new world of wonders. The Lord is with them.
Yes, God does work wonders. Rejoice and be glad.
Lord, bring us back as water to thirsty land.
Those sowing in tears will reap singing and laughing.
They left weeping and casting the seed. They come back singing and holding high the harvest.
We pray. Creator God, you prepare a new way in the wilderness, and your grace waters our desert. Open our hearts to be transformed by the new thing you are doing, that our lives may proclaim the extravagance of your love given to all through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated. The first reading is from Isaiah chapter 43, starting at verse 16. The prophet declares that long ago God performed mighty deeds and delivered Israel from Egyptian bondage through the waters of the sea. Now God is about to do a new thing, bringing the exiles out of Babylon and through the wilderness in a new exodus. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings out chariot and horse, army and warrior. They lie down, they cannot rise. They are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The wild animals will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches, for I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert to give drink to my chosen people, the people whom I formed for myself, so that they might declare my praise. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Judas willfully misinterprets as waste Mary's extravagant act of anointing Jesus' feet with costly perfume. Jesus recognizes her lavish gift is both an expression of love and an anticipation of his burial. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of them at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 nard and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Time for the children's sermon. Kids want to come up. Give a moment. and it can be found in many homes. It is probably the most powerful and important item in any house. Whoever holds this item has ultimate control and power. And when you're, I bet you have this item in your house as well. And when you hold it, you have the power. Any guesses to what it might be? A remote control. That is right. Did you see it? I tried to hide it, it's very good job. Yeah, it's a remote control. Right? Whoever holds a remote control has power to control the TV. Turn it on and off, change the channel, raise or lower the volume. Whoever holds this has the power to watch whatever they want to watch. So, let's say that I come over to your house. We're sitting on the couch watching TV, and you have the remote control. And then you give me the remote control. Wow. You give me the power. You give it to me, and now I can control the TV. So that's pretty important, isn't it? That is pretty cool if you were to do that. To give over power and control. That must mean that you think of me as someone pretty important, that you would hand over control of the TV to me. I would use your gift wisely. We would watch sports. Right? Yeah. So in the Bible story I read, Mary is at the dinner for Jesus. And she takes this very precious ointment called nard, very expensive perfume, and pours it all over Jesus' feet, and then wipes his feet with her hair. And she is showing Jesus just how special he is to her. She is taking the most precious thing she has, not the remote control, but a 16 ounces of pure perfume, and she gives it to Jesus. It's like, you give me the remote control. She gives this gift to Jesus and says, you are the most important thing in my life. You are the most precious person I have ever met. So it's an amazing gift that Mary gives to Jesus. Let's pray. Jesus, you are the most important person in our lives. May we also be generous in giving our gift to you. Thanks for coming up to you. Go after your
grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Creator, and from our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. When we talked about this gospel at our pastor's text study, we talked about Mary's incredible generosity, giving a gift that's worth a year's salary. Now, we're coming up on tax day in just a few weeks, so think about the number you put on that total income, 1040, for the year. Would you give that up for Jesus? That's what Mary does. It's a gift worth, in these days, about $20,000 that she pours out over Jesus' feet. So we talk about Mary's incredible generosity. And then as pastors, we talk about our experiences of good and bad generosity. And one pastor shared a story from a friend of his. She was a pastor, I think it was either Ohio or Indiana. And a few years ago, a wealthy member gave the church she served, a very large donation. And he set up a trust and promised the money would be used to finance the ministry of that church. But it quickly became clear that he intended to use the money to control how ministry was done. So whenever the pastor or the council made decisions he didn't like, he would change the terms or withhold the money. And that caused conflict, of course, within the congregation, within the council. And the pastor ended up leaving because of this generous donation from this, and how he manipulated that donation. Now, if you were to ask that wealthy person if he considered himself to be generous, he would probably say yes. But his version of generosity comes with a whole bunch of strings to hold on to, right, that he pulled. So the gift becomes not a gift, but a means of control and power and personal gain. And that distorted view of generosity is not limited to just the very wealthy. People of both modest and extreme wealth are extravagantly generous, and they give with no strings at all. Use the gift however you want, it's yours now. And people of both modest and extreme wealth can be manipulative and controlling, giving, but then controlling all the strings. Because the state of our bank accounts does not determine our generosity, but the state of our hearts. So when Mary of Bethany anoints Jesus' feet with this costly perfume and then dries them with her hair, she is giving us a master class on generosity. For this gift to have any financial value to Jesus, she should just give him the whole jar. But in pouring out the perfume on his feet, she gives Jesus a momentary sensory experience of a wonderful fragrance that fills the house. But beyond that, her generous offering has no real value, which is why Judas complains about her wastefulness. But the perfume is not the point of Mary's generosity. When she gives her most prized possession, it is an offering of herself. It is her love, it is her devotion to Jesus. In the flow of John's gospel story, Mary is thanking Jesus for raising her brother Lazarus from the dead. So her generosity flows from an extremely grateful heart. And she will do anything she can to express her love and commit herself to Jesus. Her generosity is genuine, rooted in a heart that is transformed by the amazing grace and love of Jesus. And now she gives her gift, pouring out the whole jar on Jesus' feet, means she can never use her generosity to manipulate or control Jesus. There are no strings attached with her gift. So we get a stark contrast between Mary's grateful and wild generosity with Judas's hypocritical and manipulative statement. He claims to be concerned for the poor, but the little editorial notes that John puts in his gospel give us a very different picture of his soul and his heart. Where Mary gives, Judas holds back. When Mary commits to Jesus, Judas stands in judgment of them both. And this scene is a turning point in Judas's relationship with Jesus. It reveals the lack of generosity that Judas holds in his heart. Judas is far more concerned with controlling the purse and maybe dipping into it from time to time, and then in fact controlling Jesus than he is to committing himself to their ministry, to him. Much of the teaching of generosity in the church, when we hear the word stewardship, what do you think of? Money, right? But stewardship and generosity are not about money, not always, not fully. We talk about time and talent and treasures. But our minds immediately go to money. I guess the most important thing. But it's not. Not for Jesus. In Luke, when he sees the widow put her 2 pennies into the offering for the temple, his response shows he is far more interested in this widow's heart, in her gift, than in the amount of what she gives. So ultimately, generosity is about being extravagant with ourselves, and opening our hearts to others, giving whatever resources we have, good of our neighbor. This kind of generosity cannot be controlled. It does not depend on our financial resources or lack thereof. True generosity is not measured by how much we give, but how we give. How generous we are with ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Now, our world suffers from a belief that there is not enough to go around. Remember when the pandemic shutdown began, low these 2 years ago, and everybody ran out and bought toilet paper? Remember that? Hoarding toilet paper. Couldn't find it. Scarcity scares people. That thought. Wars and conflicts erupt over our desire to control both what we have and access to what we might need in the future. That scarcity mentality imprisons us. Scarcity prevents us from giving ourselves generously to others. Scarcity closes our fists around the stuff we are afraid to lose. And we'll never find peace or security or justice or joy if all we see is closed fists around what we have. All we see is scarcity. Jesus calls us to the wild generosity of Mary, the generosity that sees that there is an abundance in our world. There is enough for everyone. Generosity that gives deep and heartfelt thanks for what we have. Generosity rooted in our willingness to give ourselves to one another and to help make our corner of the world just a little bit better place. This wild generosity does not require grand gestures or a large trust fund. From hearts, being open to those around us and sharing what we have, which connects us back to Matthew 25. When we feed the hungry, when we give water to the thirsty and clothe the naked and visit the sick and welcome the stranger and help the least and the lost and the last, we are pouring perfume on Jesus' feet. We are helping Jesus with the generosity we've learned from Mary. As we are hopefully coming to the end of this pandemic, with all the scarcity and struggle that we've seen over these past 2 years, living out the wild generosity of Mary is life-giving for the people who need our help. And it brings us joyful and grateful hearts. For that we say thanks be to God. Our hymn of the day in 335. Would you please stand as you are?
Thank you.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. For the prayers, I will end each petition with the words, Merciful God, and your response will be, Receive our prayer. Drawing close to the heart of God, we offer these prayers for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Do a new thing in the church. Free us from patterns that no longer serve the gospel, and bring forward leaders who imagine fresh ways of sharing your good news. Give us courage in the face of change. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Do a new thing for creation. Reverse the course of climate change and environmental tragedy. Revive habitats already damaged by human neglect. Strengthen the voices and inspire the work of scientists and researchers. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Do a new thing in our world. Break the barriers preventing political enemies from working together for the security of all. Make a way for peace and cooperation among the nations, especially Ukraine and Russia. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Do a new thing for those who suffer. Reveal a path for people unemployed or underemployed, for those experiencing homelessness, and for all who struggle with money. Comfort those who grieve and restore those who are sick. We pray for Al, Dolores, Delbert, Kathy, Ron, Jim, Joan, Matt, Caitlin, Brett, Brenda, Lisa, Belle, Kathy, Gary, Cheyenne, and Peter, Joy, Susan, Pete, Jacoby, Paul, Cindy, Gail, Jamie, Mark, Donna, Tracy, Ellen, Paul, and Kim, and all with COVID-19. For medical researchers, hospital personnel, doctors and nurses, especially Deb, Holly, Joy, Kara, Lily, Todd, and Bonnie. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Do a new thing within us. Direct us to the people who broaden our understanding of the human experience. Deliver us especially from the evils of racism. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Merciful God, now hear the prayers of our people. Do a new thing in our death. Fill us with the knowledge of Christ and the power of his resurrection, as we give thanks for all the saints who have attained the prize of their heavenly call. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Accept the prayers we bring, O God, on behalf of a world in need, for the sake of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The offering plate is on the table in the back center aisle. If you didn't put your offerings in on the way in this morning, you can do so on the way out. Those worshiping at home, we thank you for sending your offerings in as well. We pray for all these offerings at this time, and I'll turn on the microphone so you can hear me. We pray. Extravagant God, you have blessed us with the fullness of creation. Now we gather at your feast where you offer us the food that satisfies. Take and use our offerings, come among us, and feed us with the body and blood of Christ, in whose name we pray.
Amen.
We come to this table in need. We are weak and need strength. We are broken and need healing. We are hearted and need softening. We are poor in spirit and need care.
In great compassion, God invites us to share in this meal where we receive again God's abundant grace. We remember how Jesus gave himself for us. At supper on the night of his betrayal, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it and shared it with his friends, saying, "This is my body given for you. Take, eat, and remember me." After supper, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and shared it with his friends, saying, "This is my blood shed for you and for all for your forgiveness. Take, drink, and remember me." In this bread and wine, Christ's body and blood, we receive again the generous and costly gift of life offered to us through the sacrifice of Jesus. This meal is a proclamation of God's goodness, a thanksgiving for God's grace, and a sharing in God's life. And we will keep celebrating in this way until Jesus returns. Gathered into one by God's Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Here is food and drink for the journey. Take and be filled. Keep the seal off the bread. Receive that with the blessing of the body of Christ given for you. Take the seal off the grape juice or the wine. Receive that with the blessing of the blood of Christ is shed for you.
Thank you.
stand as you are able. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
We pray. Blessed Jesus, in this rich meal of grace, you have fed us with your body, the bread of life. Now send us forth to bear your life-giving hope to a world in need.
Amen.
You are children of God, anointed with the oil of gladness and strengthened for the journey. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you this day and always.
Amen.
We sing our ascending song in 338.
Thanks be to God.